We flipped the coin backstage, and we decided that I'm going to interview him first, and then he's going to ask me some questions, and then we're going to figure it out. So first of all, thank you all for your time and for coming and for being interested in arguably the most important thing that's going to happen in this country in the next 11 months. Econ 2016 is the name of the course, name of the class, name of the seminar this evening. Question first goes to you, Professor. I know, right? Tequila for all my friends. Jobs report comes out on Friday, right?
Yes.
Wow. Jobs report for November comes out on Friday, 8:30 in the morning, Washington time. You have worked at the highest levels of government. You've been the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors. You guys get that number early, right?
Yep.
Do you really?
Yeah.
That's a no-shit.
The CEO gets the number the night before, the afternoon, late afternoon. And there's a...
Do you get it like a secret code thing?
Yeah. And it's on a secure phone.
And oh, you're full of shit.
So it comes in... the number comes from the Department of Commerce. From the Bureau of Labor Statistics, right. Who the Department of Commerce calls us on the secure phone, what we would call the bat phone.
Mm-hmm.
And so they can't just tell you what it is. They fax over on the secure fax.
I was totally kidding.
And we prepare the report, and the president's allowed to see it, the Secretary of the Treasury. For a long time, the head of the NEC was not allowed to see it, and the chief of staff was not allowed to see it. Now, Rahm is explosively angry that he's not on. What? And I was like, look, it's the law, Rahm. You can't ask me, right? That's fine. You raise your eyes.
Wow.
If it's good, you're going to give me this. So then they changed the rule. That was some bylaw. So only a few people can see it. And the president, as you might imagine, 2009 cares a ton about this number.
A ton.
So they would, no matter where he was, even if oftentimes he'd be in Washington and they'd summon you, come over here and tell us. If not, he could be on Air Force One. And there's a phone on Air Force One, which is not a high quality phone, and it goes.
The President of the United States is on the line and wants to speak to you.
Whoa! I don't. Okay, put him through.
What did the job numbers look like?
he wants to know. So we would get it the night before. But it comes out officially at 8:30.
8:30 in the morning.
And then there's a embargo, which I don't totally understand, of exactly 1 hour before anyone from the administration is allowed to say anything about it.
Right.
It comes out at 8:30. Everybody goes, blah, 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 talks about it for an hour.
See,
and then at 9:30, they're like, and now we go to the White House.
Right.
What do you think? Exactly. What does the number mean?
All right. So all of that by way of, that's a good story. All of that by way of asking this question. What's the economic indicator you're going to be looking at in the next 11 months to give you some sense of how the economy is doing as voters head to the polls?
For me, that number is the GDP growth rate. Is not the jobs number, as we'll talk about in a second. I think we've lulled ourselves into a false sense of security, I think, about how strong is the economy by looking at the jobs numbers, which have been very strong.
Yeah.
The year 2014 and partly of 2015 are epically good years, some of the best job-creating years ever, while GDP growth has been mediocre. And the question is, forget what I just said.
All right.
The issue is, do you think that the jobs numbers are a leading indicator and that we're on the cusp of growth? Is it going to take off? Or do you think that some weird thing has been happening with jobs and they're about to come crashing back down, not to recession, but just to the kind of lousy, mediocre that the GDP has been? I think the latter, unfortunately, because 2014 was a very unusual year in that we had negative productivity growth for the United States. And, you know, not to get all algebra on you, if you looked at job performance and said, what GDP growth rate does it correspond to what we had? The answer is like 4.5%. It would be the really major boom. That's only possible, basically, job growth is output minus productivity. So if you had no growth, and 2% if you had 2% GDP growth and 2% productivity growth, right, you could have no job.
You just
squeeze it out of your existing workforce. We had a negative 2%. And that's the only reason. We had 4% job growth,
right,
2% output, minus negative 2% productivity. If productivity goes back to anything like normal,
yeah,
then what is overwhelmingly important for how is the economy going to feel is what's actually happening to growth. And I fear it's a little bit like the, you know, if you're of a certain age, you will remember the old Bugs Bunny cartoon where the guy has a dog and the dog can talk. And he's talking to the dog and he takes the dog to the newspaper because he thinks he's going to be rich. And he goes, ask this dog anything. He can answer any question. And the guy says, you know, what's your favorite part of the house? And the dog says, woof. And he goes, see, he said the roof. And he goes, who's the best baseball player? Woof. See, he said roof. You know, and then he go out and he gets, you see him thrown out and he turns to the dog and he's like, what is your problem? And the dog goes, maybe I should have said DiMaggio. You know, the, and right, what, I feel like what every question, the answer is roof. And that is, how fast are we growing? We're growing like 2%, 2.5%.
2.5%,
and
right?
Some people are like, yes, we're going to take off. And the Fed is like, it's going to be great. And then others say, no, we're about to collapse. And it's always just the same woof. You know,
so is 2.5% just plodding? Is that where you are on this?
Yeah, that's what I think. I think we're just going to kind of plod along. 2.5% is kind of the upper bound of what I think it's going to be. And so that's not great. It's not horrible. But I kind of think for 2016, most of the Democrats I talk to basically think the Republicans are crazy. They're going to nominate Donald Trump or somebody who's it's going to make it easy, and the economy is going to be booming, and so it's going to be great.
No, that's not going to happen.
And I really don't think that. Yeah. I really don't think it is. I think it's going to be a lot tougher environment.
When you think of the systemic problems we have, this is a corollary to the next one. Then, if you think GDP is the indicator, how important is our jobs and wages then? Right, because if you're discounting unemployment,
yeah,
but what we need for economic growth is people spending money out there. How are they going to do that without a 9-to-5 and a decent living wage?
Yes and no. I don't disagree that the weakest thing in the economy over the last 25 years is just basic ordinary Americans' wages haven't been going up that, like they were
right
in the past. They're real wages, but I would just caution you, I think the reason the Fed has screwed this up so royally.
Stop right there. Have they?
Yeah, with their forecasts. That's what the Fed has screwed up royally with their forecasts, undeniably, for 8 straight years.
They've been saying, oh my God,
we're about to take right off starting next year.
Right.
And don't. Okay? Right. And right, so in 2009, right, they said it would be 10. We're finally going to take off. Yeah. 10, 11, yeah, 12, 13, 14. Because in the Fed's model, there's a lot of extremely capable economists within the Fed doing the forecast. But forecasting has been given up by academics. You go to academic economics department, nobody does forecasting because they say it's impossible.
What the hell do you guys do then?
we study the economy. What drives the economy.
Now that we know that.
Not
I feel much better now.
Not prediction. All right. All okay, right. So in the same way, if you went to the doctor and if you ask them, what day am I going to die? They're not going to have right a great sense, but they're going right to say, you shouldn't smoke, you should exercise, right, you know, be careful, take your medicine. They have in their machine a reversion to the mean. And it's fine. Right. There's a lot of investors who have the same thing, that they're waiting for stuff to get back to normal.
It eventually gets back to normal, right.
And getting back to normal in their mind is defined as what it was in 2006. In 2006,
it wasn't normal.
Right. And the reason
that was
I
totally
say
not
that,
rehearsed. That was totally not rehearsed. I have this conversation
question
all the time. It's not normal.
But
yeah,
the premise of your question that what we need is for people to go back and spend, and until people start right spending, we can't grow again. That's what's in the Fed's model. The
yeah
Fed's model says, well, we know what happens when house prices go up. People start spending money. When gas prices go down, they're going to spend all of that money
right
on stuff, and they're going to build houses. And so we're right around the corner from a takeoff. And I kind of don't think we actually are going to get people spending a ton. Okay. Uh-oh. The Fed.
God is angry.
The Fed.
Janet Yellen heard that.
You know, I'm friends with Janet Yellen. You're doing a good job, Janet.
That's right. All right, wait.
So I think it's going to need to be more exports and more capital investment-led growth than it was in the 2000s. The 2000s were not sustainable. Consumer spending more than they were earning in income.
Yep.
House construction based on house price appreciation, something like 10 times greater than the historic average, neither of which is sustainable. So we're going to have to shift what the economy is doing. And that is my reasoning of why it hasn't been a faster comeback. It never was V-shaped because we couldn't go back to doing what we were doing before it began.
All right, we're going to geek out here for about 2 seconds. I want to follow up on exports and capital investment. So if we're going to lead, if exports are going to lead our growth, you need a weaker dollar.
Yes,
dollar is crazy strong.
It's killing us.
Crazy strong.
Exactly. This is why when the Fed is like, oh, we think 2016's a year we're going to take off so we can start raising the rates. I go, no, wait a minute. You know, the dollar's already high. Now the U.S. interest rates are going to start rising while everybody else is going down. The dollar's going to go up even more.
All right. So that's a problem. Number two, capital investment. So you want companies to actually spend money.
Right.
Well, let me just stop right there. You want companies to spend money instead of returning it to shareholders.
And not just buy other companies with it.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's
been slow.
All right. All right. Thus endeth the geeky thing. Sorry. You guys can follow up with questions if you like, which we will do in like 25 minutes. I want to ask you about the thing that we're looking at Marketplace as we think about our election coverage, and that is this. The economic recovery has been going now for 75-something months, six-plus years, June 2009, right?
Yep.
Unemployment rate is 5.0%. The economy is growing, not as fast as you want, but it's growing. The headline numbers are, if not really, really good, then certainly solid.
They look normal.
Yeah. How come when I go out and talk to people, like I'm going to go down to Memphis tomorrow and do a bunch of interviews for our election coverage, they don't feel it out there? Their own economies feel lousy. What's the disconnect?
One, I don't think it's a disconnect. I think ordinary incomes of the median family haven't gone up in a long time. And economists argue about stuff, I mean, to really get in the weeds, is it about the price indices? Are we just not measuring? You know, now everybody has a phone. Mm-hmm. There's a famous book on economic growth that begins with King Leopold, whatever, he's the richest man in the world, and he's playing with his money, and he slams the chest that the gold pieces are in on his finger, and he gets an infection, just some basic infection, and he dies. Okay. And so it asks, what does it mean that the richest man in the world dies of a thing that the poorest person in the United States can just walk in a van for 50 cents, get an antibiotic? So is the poorest person today richer than the richest man in the world in 1400? Okay, now that's actually a question of price indices. So there is some dispute over the notion that middle class wages have been falling. And they say, no, we just haven't been measuring all the new stuff. But I think people know how much money they themselves have, and it hasn't gone up that much. People haven't gotten raises. There's been a lot of job insecurity. We had a horrible recession. All of those is part of it. And the second is, in politics, I can only think of two moments ever, or at least in our memories, where the political leaders were willing to get up and say, this is good and we did this. And those two moments are 1984, when the GDP growth rate is literally 6%, and the end of the 90s, when we have the stock market rising literally 25% a year for several years in a row, and we've added, you know, 20 million jobs. Both of those moments, totally off trend, not, you know, way three standard deviations above the mean. The fact that, so we were talking about it with a common friend of ours, Gene Sperling, was in the White House in 1996. And he says that in 1996, there was a big argument for the 96 election. Should we say the economy's better, or should we say we know the economy stinks, but it's not our fault, we inherited a problem? And they went back and forth, and they finally decided they would say, though we know there are some problems, we think the economy is getting better. 1996 was amazing. We're in the middle of an epic boom. The fact that they still were arguing in the White House about should we say the economy stinks, I think partly tells you politics has a very high bar before they're going to be willing to say anything positive.
So let me take you to politics for a minute. My boss, Deborah Clark, who's the executive producer of Marketplace, she's sitting right there.
She likes it.
Say hi, Deborah.
Boss.
I know, she loves
it. Yeah, she's like, yes.
She loves it.
Do as I say.
We had at your connecting us, we had breakfast this morning with David Axelrod, who is, as you guys know, the founder of this institute. And he had some very interesting things to say about politics and the economy and where we are today. I would be curious as to your take on, just because you spent 3 years in Washington, right? Your take on what is happening on the Republican side today with the economic populism and also on the Democratic side with Bernie Sanders and the state of the economy as we just described it, which is people aren't feeling it.
I mean, it seems like you don't have to be an Axelrod level of genius of insight into what people think to figure out those two are related. People aren't feeling it, and that leads them to other solutions or other, if they aren't solutions, claimed solutions. I think there is a guy who does research at Chicago Business School about financial crises. It's worth noting that every country that has basically ever had a financial crisis and had to bail out its financial system, the politics always become massively divisive and very populist, and essentially the fingers begin pointing over whose fault was this. Once they get past the, are we going to live?
Yeah.
Then everybody's like, woo, okay, we live. Now, who did this? You did this. You did this. No, it wasn't our fault. It was the banks. No, it was the government. No, it was the Republicans. It was the Democrats. You know, so that is not unusual. What's happened in the United States, the like poisonous partisanship is not unusual after financial crisis. And it's not unusual at this moment in a presidency. People forget. So the right before the midterm, the president came to town and he spoke about Northwestern. And I hadn't seen him for a while. And they called and they said, oh, he would really, you know, can you come up? He'd like to see you. And I came up. And so first I told him, I said, you know, the economy would probably be doing better if you weren't spending all your time with these Kellogg people. You know, and you came back down. And he was in pretty good spirits, but everyone around him was like totally in the dumps. And they knew they were going to lose the midterm, and they're like just really sour. And I said, guys, they were envious. You seem so happy and rested and blah, blah, blah. And I said, look, guys, I said, I know what you feel like. It's the last 2 years, and there's gridlock, and you can't get anything done, and there's partisanship, and you can't get people to stay, and you can't attract talent. Everybody's trying to bail out. And they're like, you don't even know. It's worse than that. It's worse. And I said, think of it this way. The last 2 years under George W. Bush, they were literally bookended by Hurricane Katrina and the worst financial crisis. So, you know, Bill Clinton's last 2 years, the man was impeached. Bush, the dad, voted out of office. Ronald Reagan, Iran-Contra. Jimmy Carter, hostage crisis, voted out of office. You got Watergate, Vietnam, assassination. Dwight Eisenhower had a heart attack and literally had to lay in his bed for 7 months of his last 2 years. I said, maybe it's going great. I mean, just brag about it. Look, there's what we did. We didn't do anything. I mean, you come to the tail end, I kind of think the main thing that's happening now is what always happens in year six, which is they're just trying to set up for 2017. Yeah. Because when stuff happens is once a new person comes in and you got a new mandate.
I want to ask you actually about the financial crisis because it, you know, Bear Stearns went under or was saved in March of 2008. Lehman Brothers was September. I mean, this is like ancient history practically.
Yeah.
And we're still feeling it. Yeah. I'm guessing you're not surprised, but should the rest of us be surprised?
Feeling it, meaning the economy's not doing better,
or
feeling it,
we're still arguing feeling about it the psychically, same stuff. And we're still arguing about it.
I'm still a little surprised. if a surprising thing just happens over and over, eventually you stop being surprised by it. But there was a huge debate within the transition and then at the beginning of the White House, manifested in the stimulus, which went, what is going to be the nature of this recovery? And one group said, it's going to be V-shaped recovery. You know, whenever the farther down it goes for you guys this way, the farther down it goes, the faster it's going to come back. So the last thing you want to do in stimulus is something that's going to take 6 years, because by the time that happens, we're already going to be booming. It's just going to be inflationary, and that's the usual problem of stimulus. So their thing was, shift everything into 2009. Do the first home buyer tax credit and cash for clunkers and a bunch of stuff that's like, move it forward. Second group said, no, this is the chance of infrastructure and let's make it a long-lived thing. And then there was a third group that said, we got to get Republican votes, so let's just make as much of it tax cuts as we can, because they'll agree to that. So they went back and forth, no, it's going to be V-shaped. And they did the Washington way, is give everybody a third of what they want and just do them all. And that's what they did. The stimulus was almost literally one-third the short-run stuff, one-third tax cuts, one-third the long-lived stuff. And for anybody who was for that short stuff, this is a big puzzle, how we still live with it. For the people who are more for the long-term, it's not a puzzle at all. They said, whenever you have a financial crisis, it's going to take a while. That's proved, I do think, on the stimulus, that kind of tells you. Sometimes they'll say, if you could do it over, would you do anything different? And I say, well, yeah, obviously, knowing after the fact that it wasn't going to be a V-shaped recovery, do you really care that fewer people, you know, that they move the cash for clunkers into 2009 instead of 2010? You wouldn't have spent money on any of that stuff. You would have put it all into the longer run stuff. But I think now we're sort of back to a norm. The first 2 years of the recovery were noticeably worse than almost any previous recovery. Now we've kind of caught back up, and this just basically looks like a garden variety recovery. It's not a huge boom. It's not 1984. It's not 1999. But there are others that are worse than this. It's just kind of, it's okay. And that's basically where it is.
Let me get you back to your first answer, and then I will surrender the floor. You started talking about how you think maybe it's not going to be so good in the jobs market and GDP going forward. When's that going to happen?
When is what going to happen?
The bad stuff.
See, I don't view it as epically bad either. And so we go through these moments where now it feels to me like people are too optimistic, but we've just gone through people too pessimistic. And when is it going to happen? It's already happened. We've had exactly what it's been the last 4 years. That's what I think it's going to be for the next one.
Is this the new normal then? Should we all just get used to unemployment at 5% with stagnant wages, not great job growth, not great jobs, GDP at 2.5% and get the hell over it?
In the short run, yes. In the long run, absolutely not. The secular stagnationists are arguing the
explain
new normal.
Explain what that means.
The secular stagnationists argue that we are in a period of secular stagnation, that for really decades to come, 2% is the best we're going to do. And their message is essentially get used to disappointment.
Right.
And that message is rooted, there are two camps. One camp says it's because all the good ideas have been had, so productivity growth will never come back to anything like normal. And the other camp says, essentially, we have aging populations, demand is going to be below where it needs to be forever, and without public infrastructure or government spending to kind of kick consumption back up, we're just going to teeter around the floor, except for those periods where we have bubbles and people think they're richer than they are and spend too much money, and then we have collapses. So it's 2% is our best with, you know, big drops along the way. For these guys, if you ask me over the next 24 months, I'm probably well below the median on growth. And for 10 years from now, I'm probably well above the median. Because I think if you plot per capita income in the United States since 1789 to today, it's basically a constant growth rate over that entire time fueled by innovation, entrepreneurship, and the general expansion of our people, human capital. Right. And there's nothing really that's changed in the last 5 years about that. And it, you can see the depression, and you can see a bunch of things where it dips below the line, but it comes back and gets on that line. And what these, what the stagnation guys are doing is literally taking this little bit on the end of a 200 plus year line that looks bad and extrapolating that forward for 25 years and saying, oh my God, by 2050, we're gonna have $200 of income per year and we're all gonna die. And I just think it's serious, that's crazy. I mean, if you just take a step back, I think it's basically right. Crazy.
All right. That's all I got.
Okay.
You can go to the floor, you can ask, you can whatever.
Oh,
you can
I was gonna ask
all
you.
Right. All right.
If I look and I see, whoa, China, Europe, a bunch of things that look scary.
Yeah.
If you talk, you talk to tons of American business leaders and people in the business community. How prepared are they for that?
Yeah.
Is what's happening in the rest of the world, how influential is it on keeping us slow? Is it because right. They're afraid of that?
They think about it all the time. I talked to a lady in Delaware, Pennsylvania. She runs the Delaware Steel Company of Pennsylvania. Her name is Lisa. I can't remember her last name, which makes me look like Marn. I apologize. I talk to her probably once every 6 weeks. She runs this steel plant, and she is worried about the Chinese. She's worried about European tariffs. She's worried about all of that stuff. She's worried about regulation. That whole everything that you hear small businesses quoted in the paper is saying, that actually happened. She says all that stuff. And it's top of mind every single day for her, every day.
I see. Yeah. And if you talk to them, does politics make any difference to them?
Yeah, you know, they've and this goes for my catfish farmer down in Greensboro, Alabama, who I was with about 6 weeks ago. It goes for Ken Lennox, my cattle rancher in Rolla, Missouri, who we check in with every now and then. It goes for the lady who runs the mall in Billings, Montana. And it goes for this Delaware Steel Company lady. They have given up on the American political system. They don't trust Washington as far as they can throw it. They think it's internecine. They think it's absolutely short-sighted. They don't believe that politicians have their best in their small business best interest at heart or the American people's best interest at heart. It's the most amazing and depressing thing you will ever see, because when the economic enterprise gives up on the political system, that's fundamentally a bad thing. And this goes back to a little bit what Axelrod and Deb and I were talking about this morning, right?
Yeah.
Is that companies are managing toward the next quarterly report,
right.
The profit estimate, and governments and politicians are managing to the next election. And I think we're seeing that intensified today because it's a political cycle where people have just looked at this whole entire enterprise and said, you know what, screw y'all, in essence.
Does it seem like anybody has got it figured out in the sense of, are there places where wages are going up, or industry? Is it just a story of the guys in Silicon Valley are getting rich, but they're the only ones? Or, you know, what do you see?
So we have a thing we do with James Fallows from The Atlantic. He and his wife, Deb, are owners of a small plane. He's a private pilot. And he flies. He came to us about 2 years ago? 2 years ago. And he said, he wrote me an email from an email address that I didn't recognize. And he said, is this a good address to do business with Kai Ryssdal in my marketplace? And I came about this close to dumping it, thinking it was a Nigerian scammer.
Yeah, no,
I told him this, and I'm like, you were so close to getting hacked out, right? And so I wrote him back, and I said, yes. Anyway, so he and his wife own a small plane. He's a private pilot, and he pitched us this idea of him, and I have an aviation background, right? So him and his wife flying around from small town to small town in their private plane, doing private aviation airports, not LaGuardia and LAX, right? With marketplace producers and me joining in from time to time to see what we could see looking at the American economy slice by slice, small town by relatively small city by relatively small city. And what he has found and what we have found when we have joined him is that at the local level, it's hammering along, right? We went to a steel plant, I keep mentioning steel, we went to a steel plant in Columbus, Mississippi with a guy by the name of Jim Bob Harris, and he had the money quote of the day, right? So they've got like $6 billion of investment because they've organized in the past 10 years this economic development thing. They got Airbus to come in and make helicopters. And Jim Bob, we have this tape, and it's great tape. And he said, you know, people thought we were walking around pregnant and barefoot with no teeth and burning crosses on the lawn, and now we're making things that fly. And honest to God, that's what happens. And so at the local level, you're seeing it. We were in Detroit, which is, as we all know, a really troubled city. And we went to Shinola, which is kind of an amazing sort of company and maker of watches and all that stuff. And they're doing it small and locally because, to get back to the really depressing point, they've given up on politics and the economic environment at the national level. Yeah. You know, and that, I think, to get back to my own question earlier, that I think is the disconnect, right? I think the disconnect between the headline numbers now everybody's feeling is that people out there aren't paying, they read the news and they see the 5.0 unemployment and they go, okay, fine. And the disconnect is that they have to get up and go to work every single day and they just don't pay any attention to it, you know?
In a way, it's like politics has become the Golf Channel in that sense that if you love golf, you can watch golf 24 hours a day on that Golf Channel. And I understand there's going to be a second Golf Channel that's coming in to compete with them. So you won't even have to watch the ads. Right. You know, you could just switch back and forth.
Right.
But if you don't know how to golf, which I don't, I never see, right. My life is purged of golf. I never see any golf. I don't have to watch golf. I can, watch my own channel.
And
it seems like there's 5 million people watching the politics channel and everybody else is like, what?
That's exactly
stupid.
Right. Yeah. Not even 5 million. You know, not even, and it's the Inside the Beltway channel, and then the New York Wall Street channel, and that's it.
I guess that's right. Okay, well, we wanted to save some time.
There we go.
And I'm an economist. You knew you were going to get some depressing. They thought a guy who knows about business and radio was going to be friendlier happier.
That's right.
But he delivered the same message I did. But worse, I was more optimistic than he was. You heard it.
Wow.
He was like, they've given up.
I'm an upbeat guy.
Okay, so we've got roving microphones, I think.
We do.
And I'll just give you one warning. There's a little theater in the old executive office building, the White House Theater. And when they crank up the lights, if you're sitting on the stage, you can't really see. So I would always say, we have people with a microphone, so we can't see you, but we can hear you. So if you have the microphone, just assume you have the floor. And it was early, it was 2009, and they had this conference about small business and why isn't small business coming back faster? And there's always one guy, the guy in the front row stands up with the first question, raises his hand, he stands up, they hand him the microphone, but it turns out there were two microphones. So that guy goes to say something, and somebody else over the speaker starts making the most offensive pronouncement. He's like, what this problem in this country is, women took all men's jobs and the following groups are lazy and something, and everybody's like, oh, and they look, and everybody assumes it's this guy in the front, and he's just like, what? And he throws it down and he yells, like, he's like, it's not me. Yeah. So, okay, but here, everyone can see you, so just be mindful, when you ask a question of that fact.
But okay, there are two microphones, I'll tell you that. Yeah. All right, ready, go.
Here, we got one right in the front. Oh, all right.
Hi, in the state of Illinois, it's worse than watching golf. It's like watching grass grow. So, Kai, you're welcome to Illinois. We've been 5 months without a state budget.
I thought you were going to say like some mixed martial arts. UFC.
I don't do sports. So when we think about the impact of no budget in the state of Illinois and how it's really hitting the most vulnerable and removing safety nets, how do we think about, how is growth even possible for bringing people out of the bottom? And then how it's impacting sort of very middle class and working middle class people with very basic needs like childcare subsidies.
Thoughts? I mean, partly this goes to the same thing that we're both talking about here, which is how important is the government to growth? And in the short run, we could go 6 months. I have no doubt we could go for a year or a year and a half or something without a budget. And certain groups are going to be hurt. A lot of people, you're going to talk to them, but they're going to say, well, I didn't even know the government was shut down. I don't know who the governor is. I don't know. I've given up on politics. I'm not interested. And my own view on that is there's a big clash of worldviews of where does growth come from. And partly it's kind of fallen out in a partisan way, partly not. One worldview says it is from the absence of government that growth comes from. And if you believe in that, it says get the taxes as low as possible, get the regulations as low as possible, and the economy will grow. And the other side says, that it's the quality of your people and their talent and investments in some public infrastructure and backbone that you got to lay the groundwork for growth. And I'm more in the latter camp. My question to the people who say it's all about low taxes is, why are places like Silicon Valley in California, which has always been a high tax, high regulation state? And the answer is obvious. It's because that's where the talented people are. And it's not, there's an island called Vanuatu. It's a nation. And as I understand it, the island of Vanuatu has no taxes of any kind on anything. And there are some audiences who, when I finish, they're like, where is this island of Vanuatu? You know, but why isn't Silicon Valley in Vanuatu, where there are no taxes? And the answer is because there are no Stanford graduates there. There's no coders. You got it. And it costs money to get your people up to that kind of level. I'm nervous over the long run that even if we can go 6 months or a year or whatever and we can make it work, that fundamentally, if we're shooting ourselves in the foot, I'm nervous for the what does that mean for the future of Illinois compared to other states. But yeah, I don't really have an answer of how you fix the standoff, because you know it's almost like it's a battle of identity, not just interests. And identity is a lot harder to figure out than interests. Yeah.
No, I would just, to get back to the beginning of what Austan was saying, right? There are some groups that are going to be hurt because, just for example, childcare services won't be available and single moms or single dads won't be able to drop their kid off and get to the job, so they're going to have to stay home and they're going to lose those jobs. And that's where you see the damage happening, right? At those lower levels among the most vulnerable populations, which are, as we all know, the most invisible populations, right? And that's where the real damage is done. And that's sort of the long-term stressor point, I think, as you start thinking about how this plays out over time, whether it's 6 months or a year. That's all I got.
I like how you used the phrase stressor
point.
In a sentence. That was that was impressive. Okay,
if you got
a microphone,
you get to talk.
You have the floor. Yeah,
there you go.
Simpson Bowles, was it a good idea? Why didn't it happen? And are the sequester cuts moving us in that direction?
That's a great question. So, Bowles Simpson was the deficit reduction commission set up by the president, Erskine Bowles and Alan Simpson, former senator from Wyoming. Made some very stringent recommendations on deficit reduction that were not adopted by your former boss. Discuss.
First, it was Simpson Bowles. It wasn't Bowles Simpson.
Oh.
Because Simpson himself said, if it was Bowles Simpson, then everybody would abbreviate it the BS committee, and so he didn't want that. So they called it Simpson Bowles. It essentially took what I thought was a very mature attitude toward deficit. It said, let's not get in a sky is falling, scare tech. Let's add up. If you wanted to stabilize the debt to GDP ratio of the United States and started shrinking, how much deficit reduction would you need to do over 10 years? And they got a target amount. And then they said, okay, let's not punt it off to, you know, let's come up with an actual plan to do it. And they did it the Washington way. There was a couple of trillion of tax increase, we get some on cutting discretionary spending, we get some from cutting entitlements, and we'll add the whole thing together. Now, there's a bogusness in Washington. There's at least one bogusness in Washington budget accounting, which is, they don't do anything in net present value. They add it up over 10 years. So 1 trillion of the 4 trillion was saved interest payments, okay, which in my world is not a thing, but they counted part of their deficit reduction would come from saved interest payments. The Simpson-Bowles Commission itself was not able to vote to support its own plan.
Right.
Because it was made up of Republicans and Democrats, and the Republicans in the House said, we won't tolerate any tax increases. So it was just a personal recommendation of Simpson and of Bowles. It was the chairman's recommendation. The reason why at the moment it came out, Obama did not feel that he could just say, I want to do Simpson-Bowles, is in it, he had made a promise not to raise anyone's taxes less than $250,000.
Right.
And one of the first things in Simpson-Bowles was raise taxes on a lot of people, including less than 250,000. And the president, I think, was, I love as the professor to be able to say somebody's being politically naive, but I do think they were being, Simpson and Bowles were being a little politically naive to think that the president would just get up and say, I embrace cutting Social Security, raising taxes on the middle class as a rational and mature starting point, let's have a negotiation. He thought, quite correctly, that if he did that, the first thing they would do is say, we told you he's a liar, and he's a liar, now he's proposed to do it. Though he did say at that time, if you want to have the negotiation over the grand bargain, I will have it with you. But we all will have to give up, so we will have to have high-income tax cuts, plus the cuts you want to get. If you want to have that, let's have it. And my feeling, we could go back in the history, was the original Ryan budget, instead of saying Simpson-Bowles was essentially $2 trillion of cuts, $1 trillion of revenue. The president wanted $2 trillion of cuts, I mean, $2 trillion of tax increases, right, and $2 trillion for $2 trillion of cuts. And the first Ryan budget was negative $1 trillion tax cuts, and pay for it with a big, with that much more government spending cuts. So it was just kind of, they weren't going anywhere. And I'll just give you one money quote, and we'll go to the next one. I asked the pollster, they came back later, and they said, ask the pollster, why don't they do Simpson-Bowles? So I asked the president's pollster, Joel Benenson, what do people think about Simpson-Bowles as a plan? And he said, your people all want to know about Simpson-Bowles. And I said, yes. They asked me that. He said, my people in the focus groups think that's a stomach condition.
Wow.
He was like, nobody's talking about Simpson-Bowles. It's not on anyone. They don't even know anything about it or what it is. And that was kind of the golf channel. It's back to the golf channel.
Yeah. Who's got the mic? Let's work them down front here, shall we? There we go.
I have a question. In a zero interest rate environment, how do you expect corporate leadership to choose investment and capital spending and research, which would improve productivity, over buying stock back in asset appreciation? How do you expect corporate leadership to make that choice in a zero interest rate environment?
I actually expect corporations to understand social responsibility and what that means and the role of the corporation in modern society. I don't know what you think.
Okay. I would say, to be more theoretical about it, the 0% interest environment ought to, in our normal economic world, ought to encourage capital investment like never before. What matters in the formula, an economist got a formula for everything, but the formula says that cost of capital should matter, which is the interest rate plus the depreciation rate times the tax treatment. The tax treatment has basically never been more favorable for investment. The interest rate is zero. If there ever was a moment when you should be saying it's worth making costs today that will pay off in the future, it's at the moment when we have zero interest rate, and yet
they
are.
So why aren't they doing that? Why aren't they doing it?
I think it's because they're still lurking down in the reptilian brain of our business leaders, this experience of the financial crisis in which their friends who did not have liquid assets died. And so they're like, I'm never going to put myself in that position again. I'm going to be King Leopold, and I'm going to have some boxes of money right here at my firm, and I'm going to sit on this money. Because if it really hits the fan again, the bank pulled my lines of credit and I couldn't get any money, and I know guys that went under. And so there's like a buffer stock of savings that corporations never had before, that now they sit on cash. If you look at the cash, and it's not just in the U.S. So that's what makes me think it's not from U.S. policy that they're not investing. This is in all the advanced countries of the world, you see the same thing. Super low interest rates, they're sitting on money, they're profitable, and yet they're not investing. And so I think it's that. Now, you seem skeptical.
Well, I think you're letting them off the hook a little bit, right? Because it's been that way for a long, long time. When tax environments have been favorable, and interest rates have been relatively low, companies have you know, sat on their money, and they are quite often loath to make those capital investments because it's spending money without the, you know, necessarily the promise of return.
That may be true. I think that's a better way of saying what I'm saying. I don't think they think stuff's going that great, and their view is we built a bunch of overcapacity, so why would we go build new factories? You know, a bit like the juniorized version of what's happened in China.
Yep.
Okay, China used to be an export-based model, and they aren't really an export-based model anymore. They're an investment-led model because the government tells them, we got problems, build more factories. There was a Simpsons. If you ever watch the Simpsons, Maggie's the baby, and they put Maggie in this daycare, and they throw all the babies in this big pit of plastic balls. And it turns out, from the baby's perspective, it's a nightmare. They hate them all. They're this. And they struggle, and they finally climb to the top. And you see Maggie waving to the person, you know, sucking on the pacifier. And the assistant says, the children seem agitated. And then he goes, add more balls. You know, dump all the balls. That's China. That's China with this. Yeah. They're just like, things are slowing. There are problems. Yep. Build more factories. You know, they build them, but... Boy, when you do that, when left to the private sector, if you got overcapacity, I think that's mostly why they're.
Yeah, that's why they're. We've got the mic. Here we go.
Thank you for the opportunity. So I understand and agree with the point that maybe not many people are paying close attention to national politics, but I don't think that automatically makes national politics irrelevant. Likewise, not many people, I think, are paying attention to Wall Street, but all of a sudden it goes crazy and drag everybody down, even though, including those people, having zero interest in it. So I guess my question is, even though we accept that maybe national politics wouldn't do any favor to the economy, would it be possible that it would pose serious threat or risk to the economy in the next couple of years? Thank you.
Oh, so can Congress and the government hurt the economy? I don't know. Let me ask you, and then I'll weigh in, because I went first last time.
Okay. I think that's an insightful question. Yep. Thank you for asking it that way. I don't disagree with you that they could. It's a bit of a joke, but it's not really a joke to say, if I told you that they weren't going to do a single thing for 2 years until the next president was elected, truly, that's the best case scenario that could happen. That's probably what will happen, but with a 5% chance that like something really awful happens. They default on the U.S. debt for no reason, or there's some huge tax increase, or some massive government shutdown or something like that. That said, 90% of what happens in the economy has nothing to do with Washington. So mostly I don't think, if you ask what are the true black swans that would freak everyone out, I think they're to be found China or Europe. It's not really the U.S., not really Washington. Stuff could be very frustrating. Consumer confidence, for whatever reason, does respond quite negatively to government shutdowns. And yeah, I don't know if it's the, like, we don't like to see our parents fighting or what is the thing, but... Mm-hmm. The only thing bigger than 9/11, bigger than anything except Lehman in 2008, the fall of Lehman and the financial crisis, that first threatened government shutdown in 2011 cut consumer confidence more than anything except Lehman. It was the biggest drop ever, and the second biggest drop after Lehman was over the government shutdown this last time. So I think they could do that, but I still think that's kind of on the margin. I mean, it's a $17 trillion economy, and Washington's only on the margins.
Yeah, I completely agree. I would throw in the specter of a debt default. I could see somehow, even with Paul Ryan and in theory some kind of change in the guard, I could see that getting dangerously close to the point where the bond market just goes, people are out of your mind.
It kills me. Okay, first of all, I don't even think any other country in the world has a debt ceiling.
Right.
Okay, they don't. That doesn't exist. The market is the debt ceiling. The market tells you, we will not lend you any more money because we think you've borrowed too much. Okay, that's how the world works. And countries around the world are desperate not to do that. They'll do anything not to default because they know it would. The thought that a country would be like, you know what, we're going to default. We have, but you can make the payment. Yeah, but I don't want to. You know, you're pissing me off, so I'm not going to pay. It's just crazy. You might be right.
And you can see that happening. A couple more, I think, maybe, huh? Who's got the microphones? There we go.
All right. Thank you very much. So my question is, what's going to happen when the Federal Reserve goes belly up? Like, who's going to bail out the Federal Reserve?
They can print money.
Yeah, not
they're,
to.
They're never done that.
I'm not your professor. I'm not going to give you a grade. But that's not an accurate description of how the Fed works. The Fed is not like a regular bank. We have the what the business calls the exorbitant privilege is the fact that we can print dollars on paper that costs about 1 cent, and people will give us a dollar for it. And our debts are in our own currency. So fundamentally, there is no such thing as the Fed going belly up and us having to bail them out. That doesn't really exist. Though I would note, how dumb do you have to be to mint money at a loss? It costs more than 2 cents to make a penny. Yep. And yet we keep making these pennies.
Wait, so go on your penny rant.
Well, I guess my follow-up question would be then, how long is negative real interest rates going to be around?
That is a tougher question to figure out. I think for a while, because I told you, economists got a formula for everything, and they got a formula for what should the interest rate be. And you plug in the unemployment rate and inflation, and you plug it all in there and say, what should the interest rate be? For a long time, it said the interest rate should be negative 3.5%. And that's why the Fed engaged in quantitative easing, is because nobody can figure out how, once the interest rate hits zero, now what do you do? And they're trying to find a way to loosen monetary policy in a world where they're hitting the zero lower bound. It historically has proved very difficult to get off the zero lower bound. And the Fed is desperate to do so. You can see them, I think, because they want to be able to tell their grandkids, I was concerned. I said, weren't you concerned, Grandpa or Grandma, about the possibility of a bubble? Oh, I was. That's why I voted for the interest rate hike as soon as I could. But fundamentally, it kind of doesn't make sense. I think the reason why we're at these negative real interest rates or at zero is because we're not growing very fast. And back to the original question, that's why... Once you're growing sustainably at 3%, then we can get off of zero and everything will return back to normal. But I think it's going to be a while before we're to that.
Let's pass it on. There's lots of other people. Thanks very much for your question.
Do you think part of it is regulatory then? If the monetary can't do anything, is it? I mean, they're the QEs and everything, and it's not the money's not turning over. So is that a regulatory problem?
If by regulatory problem you mean, are regulations preventing growth? I don't. And the evidence, we know the Clean Air Act of 1977 had a negative impact on growth because we compare counties where it was binding to counties where it wasn't, and you see big differences. You don't see, the US, we changed the regulations. Canada, Europe, Japan didn't. And yet you see the same thing in all those countries. So I really don't think
it's more specific, like Dodd-Frank.
No, but that's what I'm telling you. Yeah. It can't be Dodd-Frank because you see the exact same thing happening in countries where there was no Dodd-Frank. So that's what makes me think it's not regulatory.
Let's go over here somewhere. Who's got the microphone?
I'm sorry, it's me. It seems to me that we're talking about growth, the desire for growth, and some sort of offset for sustainability. And one of the things that most affects it the thing that seems to most affect it is insecurity, job insecurity, health insurance insecurity, home value insecurity, Fed state budget insecurity. Who do you think among the parties and who among the candidates do you think is most prepared to give the American people the level of confidence that we need to start back on the growth curve again?
Make America great again. No, I'm just kidding. Sorry.
I don't know. Look, I'm publicly for Hillary Clinton, right. So I would say Hillary Clinton, but I think if you're kind of waiting for a Washington figure to make everybody feel better again, I kind of think that's the old style.
Let's go back to what he said a minute ago. 90%+ of what happens in the American economy cannot be affected, is for all that they talk about it, presidents and senators and representatives and you name it, they can't, it's an $18 trillion behemoth, right? And the very best they can do is nibble around the margins. Now, whether you can sell somebody politically as having that confidence, that's a whole different deal. But the actual tangible thing that an individual candidate can do, it's not really all that big.
So, you'd be irrational if something made you feel better, like, they're going to make us, they bring back confidence. I got it. Yeah. I spent a long time in the White House. I walked all around in the basement. There's what used to be the pool, which is now full of wires. I went in there. And as I say, I looked hard, and I asked the Bush people, had they found the switch that was in the basement that we could flip and say, oh, God, this thing has been off for all this time, and we just flip it, and we're ready to go, and it's not down there.
So I think that's a good segue into my question. I wonder if collective action isn't, we the people, isn't the decisive factor for the next 5 to 10 years, because absent from your commentary today is the 800-pound gorilla of climate change, deforestation, desertification, the contamination and loss of arable land for agriculture globally, and to adopt a historical perspective as though this weren't a critical time in our species history seems to me to be foolhardy.
Yes. I'm going to impute the question, but yes. But all you have to do now is find businesses willing to make those investments and recognize that sustainability is profitable in the long term. You have to find politicians on both sides of the aisle willing to pass the necessary regulations and requirements to make that happen. And then you need to decide that all of us here are going to drive Priuses and not SUVs, and that we're going to put solar cells on the roofs of our houses and do all of those things that are necessary. I mean, it's an evident good. We just have to, as a nation and as a people and as a society, gather the collective will, as you said, to be able to do that.
And I think the deep problem of this is a global problem, and the state of Vermont passed its own cap and trade bill. And you can see when it comes to Vermont that Vermont acting alone will not work. It can succeed at getting economic activity out of Vermont, but it's not going to affect global greenhouse gas emissions. The U.S. is a bigger player than Vermont, but is still, you have to get China and India especially on board. And so stuff like Paris is super important, but almost literally everybody is thinking, well, I'd like you to pay for it, and I'd like to keep growing it. So we're going to have to do more than just mobilize in the U.S. We got to get everybody in the world on board on that.
And those are the conversations they're having in Paris, right? They're literally having the who's going to pay for it conversations. Yeah. Last one, and please don't let it be you who takes this conversation off the rails.
Hi.
We've got the microphone. Hi.
As an avid marketplace listener, I cannot let this question go. Actually, I guess it's more of a game.
He's liking the sound.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm like, what?
Well, anyone who doesn't listen to Marketplace, I can't imagine anyone in here. Typically Kai asks this question, and the answer has to be in 5 words or less.
Oh, yeah.
And Kai typically dodges this, I think. So,
I do not. So the question is, what is your job, or what does your company do in 5 words or less?
What is Janet Yellen?
Oh, what is
thinking?
Janet Yellen? Oh, that's the other question. What is Janet Yellen
thinking
now? Right.
Yes.
So this is a game we played on the air. So let me back up for a minute. So about 3 years ago, I had Meg Whitman on the radio, CEO of Hewlett-Packard, now Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. And I, just to get something different out of her, because, oh my God, she might be a decent CEO, but she's so on message. It just kills you, right? We recorded for 20 minutes, and there were like 3 usable minutes, because she was just so repetitive. So I said, tell me what Hewlett-Packard does in 5 words or less. And she went humana, 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 and took like 15 or 16 words to do it, and she couldn't do it. And I realized we had something there. My boss hates when I ask this question. She thinks it's cheap and gimmicky. I, however, like it, because it makes CEOs think.
Because it's cheap and gimmicky.
Because it's cheap and gimmicky, but it's got good effect. I asked Obama, and I, for all the world, I was expecting him to say, preserve, protect, defend the Constitution, right? And he went on for like 3 minutes with like, well, I want to make sure everybody has equal opportunity. I'm like, sure, five words. So even he can do it. Market, so what is Janet Yellen thinking in five words or less is what we started doing when the September meeting rolled around and everybody was like, oh my God, they're not going to raise rates. And then they didn't. So Janet Yellen right now is thinking December, almost certainly, I think. There you go. What do you got?
Janet Yellen is thinking 2016 is the year raise.
There you go. That's fine. All right. Right? There we go. That's five. We're good. Steve, that's over great. Here, man.
Please join me in thanking Kai Ryssdal and Austan Goolsbee for a great conversation.
There we go.
Thank you all so much. Thanks for everything you do for us. Thank you all for being here. We hope you enjoyed it, and we hope to see you at an upcoming politics event. Politics.uchicago.edu is the IOP's web address.
I'm feeling it. I'm guessing you're not surprised, but should the rest of us be surprised?
Feeling it, meaning the economy's not doing better,
the
or feeling it,
feeling
we're
it,
still
we're
arguing
feeling
about
it
the
psychically,
same stuff.
And we're still arguing about it.
I'm still a little surprised. If a surprising thing just happens over and over, eventually you stop being surprised by it. But there was a huge debate within the transition and then at the beginning of the White House, manifested in the stimulus, which went, what is going to be the nature of this recovery? And one group said, it's going to be V-shaped recovery. You know, whenever the farther down it goes for you guys this way, the farther down it goes, the faster it's going to come back. So the last thing you want to do in stimulus is something that's going to take 6 years, because by the time that happens, we're already going to be booming. It's just going to be inflationary, and that's the usual problem of stimulus. So their thing was, shift everything into 2009. Do the first home buyer tax credit and cash for clunkers and a bunch of stuff that's like, move it forward. Second group said, no, this is the chance of infrastructure and let's make it a long-lived thing. And then there was a third group that said, we got to get Republican votes, so let's just make as much of it tax cuts as we can, because they'll agree to that. So they went back and forth, no, it's going to be beach. And they did the Washington way, is give everybody a third of what they want. Yeah. And just do them all. And that's what they did. The stimulus was almost literally one-third the short-run stuff, one-third tax cuts, one-third the long-lived stuff. And for anybody who was for that short stuff, this is a big puzzle, how we still live with it. For the people who are more for the long-term, it's not a puzzle at all. They say, whenever you have a financial crisis, it's going to take a while. That's proved, I do think, on the stimulus, that kind of tells you, sometimes they'll say, if you could do it over, would you do anything different? And I say, well, yeah, obviously, knowing after the fact that it wasn't going to be a V-shaped recovery, do you really care that fewer people, you know, that they move the cash for clunkers into 2009 instead of 2010? You wouldn't have spent money on any of that stuff. You would have put it all into the longer run stuff. But I think now we're sort of back to a norm. The first 2 years of the recovery were noticeably worse than almost any previous recovery. Now we've kind of caught back up, and this just basically looks like a garden variety recovery. It's not a huge boom. It's not 1984. It's not 1999. But there are others that are worse than this. It's just kind of, it's okay. And that's basically where it is.
Let me get you back to your first answer, and then I will surrender the floor. You started talking about how you think maybe it's not going to be so good in the jobs market and GDP going forward. When's that going to happen?
When is what going to happen?
The bad stuff.
See, I don't view it as epically bad either. And so there, we go through these moments where now it feels to me like people are too optimistic, but we've just gone through people too pessimistic. And when is it going to happen? It's already happened. We've had exactly what it's been the last 4 years. That's what I think it's going to be for the next one.
Is this the new normal then? Should we all just get used to unemployment at 5% with stagnant wages, not great job growth, not great jobs, GDP at 2.5% and get the hell over it?
In the short run, yes. In the long run, absolutely not. The secular stagnationists are arguing the
explain
new normal.
Explain what that means.
The secular stagnationists argue that we are in a period of secular stagnation, that for really decades to come, 2% is the best we're going to do. And their message is essentially get used to disappointment.
Right.
And right. That message is rooted. There are two camps. One camp says it's because all the good ideas have been had, so productivity growth will never come back to anything like normal. And the other camp says essentially we have aging populations, demand is going to be below where it needs to be forever, and without public infrastructure or government spending to kind of kick consumption back up, we're just going to teeter around the floor, except for those periods where we have bubbles and people think they're richer than they are and spend too much money, and then we have collapses. So it's 2% is our best with, you know, big drops along the way. For these guys, if you ask me over the next 24 months, I'm probably well below the median on growth. And for 10 years from now, I'm probably well above the median. Because I think if you plot per capita income in the United States since 1789 to today, it's basically a constant growth rate over that entire time, fueled by innovation, entrepreneurship, and the general expansion of our people, human capital. Right. And there's nothing really that's changed in the last 5 years about that. And you can see the depression, and you can see a bunch of things where it dips below the line, but it comes back and gets on that line. And what the stagnation guys are doing is literally taking this little bit on the end of a 200-plus year line that looks bad and extrapolating that forward for 25 years and saying, oh my God, by 2050, we're going to have $200 of income per year and we're all going to die. And I just think it's serious. That's crazy. I mean, if you just take a step back, I think it's basically crazy.
All right. That's all I got.
Okay.
You can go to the floor. You can ask, you can whatever.
Oh, I was going to ask you.
All right.
If I look and I see, whoa, China, Europe, a bunch of things that look scary.
Yeah.
If you talk, you've talked to tons of American business leaders and people in the business community. How prepared are they for that?
Yeah.
Is what's happening in the rest of the world, how influential is it on keeping us slow? Is it because they're afraid of that?
They think about it all the time. I talked to a lady in Delaware, Pennsylvania. She runs the Delaware Steel Company in Pennsylvania. Her name is Lisa. I can't remember her last name, which makes me look like Marn. I apologize. I talk to her probably once every 6 weeks. She runs this steel plant, and she is worried about the Chinese. She's worried about European tariffs. She's worried about all of that stuff. She's worried about regulation. That whole everything that you hear small businesses quoted in the paper as saying, that actually happened. She says all that stuff, and it's top of mind every single day for her, every day.
I see. Yeah. And if you talk to them, does politics make any difference to them?
Yeah, you know, they've and this goes for my catfish farmer down in Greensboro, Alabama, who I was with about 6 weeks ago. It goes for Ken Lennox, my cattle rancher in Rolla, Missouri, we check in with every now and then. It goes for the lady who runs the mall in Billings, Montana, and it goes for this Delaware Steel Company lady. They have given up on the American political system. They don't trust Washington as far as they can throw it. They think it's internecine. They think it's absolutely short-sighted. They don't believe that politicians have their best in their small business best interest at heart or the American people's best interest at heart. It's the most amazing and depressing thing you will ever see, because when the economic enterprise gives up on the political system, that's fundamentally a bad thing. And this goes back to a little bit what Axelrod and Deb and I were talking about this morning, right?
Yeah.
Is that companies are managing toward the next quarterly report, the profit estimate, and governments and politicians are managing to the next election. And I think we're seeing that intensified today because it's a political cycle where and people have just looked at this whole entire enterprise and said, you know what, screw y'all, in essence.
Does it seem like anybody has got it figured out in the sense of, are there places where wages are going up or industry? Is it just a story of the guys in Silicon Valley are getting rich, but they're the only ones? Or, you know, what do you see?
So we have a thing we do with James Fallows from The Atlantic. He and his wife, Deb, are owners of a small plane. He's a private pilot, and he flies. He came to us about 2 years ago, and he said, he wrote me an email from an email address that I didn't recognize, and he said, is this a good address to do business with Kai Ryssdal at my marketplace? And I came about this close to dumping it, thinking it was a Nigerian scammer.
Yeah, no,
I told him this, and I'm like, you were so close to getting hacked out, right? And so I wrote him back, and I said, yes. Anyway, so he and his wife own a small plane. He's a private pilot, and he pitched us this idea of him, and I have an aviation background, right? So him and his wife flying around from small town to small town in their private plane doing private aviation airports, not LaGuardia and LAX, right? With marketplace producers and me joining in from time to time to see what we could see looking at the American economy slice by slice, small town by relatively small city by relatively small city. And what he has found and what we have found when we have joined him is that at the local level, it's hammering along, right? We went to a steel plant. I keep mentioning steel. We went to a steel plant in Columbus. We flipped the coin backstage, and we decided that I'm going to interview him first, and then he's going to ask me some questions, and then we're going to figure it out. So first of all, thank you all for your time and for coming and for being interested in arguably the most important thing that's going to happen in this country in the next 11 months. Econ 2016 is the name of the course, name of the class, name of the seminar this evening. Question first goes to you, Professor. I know, right? Tequila. For all my friends. Jobs report comes out on Friday, right?
Yes.
Wow. Jobs report for November comes out on Friday, 8:30 in the morning, Washington time. You have worked at the highest levels of government. You've been the chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors. You guys get that number early, right?
Yep.
Do you really?
Yeah.
That's a no-shit.
The CEO
gets
the number the night before, the afternoon, late afternoon. And there's a...
Do you get like a secret code thing?
Yeah, and it's on a secure phone. And
oh, you're full shit.
And so, no, so it comes in, the number comes from the Department of Commerce. From the Bureau of Labor Statistics, right. Who the Department of Commerce calls us on the secure phone, what we would call the bat phone.
Mm-hmm.
And so they can't just tell you what it is. They fax over on the secure fax.
No way. I was totally kidding.
And we prepare the report. And the president's allowed to see it. The secretary of the treasury, for a long time, the head of the NEC was not allowed to see it. And the chief of staff was not allowed to see it. Now, Rahm is explosively angry that he's not on. What? And I was like, look, it's the law, Rahm. You can't ask me, right? That's fine. You raise your eyes.
Wow.
If it's good, you're going to give me this. And so then they changed the rule. That was some bylaw. So only a few people can see it. And the president, as you might imagine, 2009, cares a ton about this number.
Yeah, a ton.
So they would, no matter where he was, even if you, oftentimes he'd be in Washington and they'd summon you, come over here and tell us. If not, he could be on Air Force One. And there's a phone on Air Force One, which is not a high quality phone. And it goes,
the president of the United States is on the line and wants to speak to you.
Whoa, I don't. Okay, put him through.
What do the job numbers look like?
he wants to know. So we would get it the night before. But it comes out officially at 8:30.
8:30 in the morning.
And then there's a embargo, which I don't totally understand, of exactly 1 hour before anyone from the administration is allowed to say anything about it.
Right.
So it comes out at 8:30. Everybody goes, blah, 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 talks about it for an hour. And then at 9:30, they're like, and now we go to the White House. Right. What do you think? Exactly. What does the number mean?
All right. So all of that by way of, that's a good story. All of that by way of asking this question. What's the economic indicator you're going to be looking at in the next 11 months to give you some sense of how the economy is doing as voters head to the polls?
For me, that number is the GDP growth rate. It's not the jobs number, as we'll talk about in a second. I think we've lulled ourselves into a false sense of security, I think, about how strong is the economy by looking at the jobs numbers, which have been very strong.
Yeah.
The year 2014 and partly of 2015 are epically good years. Some of the best job-creating years ever, while GDP growth has been mediocre. And the puzzle, the question, not puzzle, the question is, wait, did I say, forget what I just said.
All right.
The issue is, do you think that the jobs numbers are a leading indicator,
right,
and that we're on the cusp of growth? Is it going to take off? Or do you think that some weird thing has been happening with jobs and they're about to come crashing back down, not to recession, but just to the kind of lousy, mediocre that the GDP has been? I think the latter, unfortunately, because 2014 was a very unusual year in that we had negative productivity growth,
yeah,
for the United States. And, you know, not to get all algebra on you,
that's
but
right,
the basic, if you looked at job performance and said, what GDP growth rate does it correspond to what we had? The answer is like 4.5%. It would be the really major boom. That's only possible, basically, job growth is output minus productivity. So if you had no growth and 2% if you had 2% GDP growth and 2% productivity growth,
right,
you could have no job growth.
You
just,
right,
squeeze it out of your existing workforce. We had a negative 2%. And that's the only reason. We had 4% job growth,
right,
2% output, minus negative 2% productivity. If productivity goes back to anything like normal,
yeah,
then what is overwhelmingly important for how is the economy going to feel is what's actually happening to growth. And I fear it's a little bit like the, you know, if you're of a certain age, you will remember the old Bugs Bunny cartoon where the guy has a dog and the dog can talk. And he's talking to the dog, and he takes the dog to the newspaper because he thinks he's going to be rich. And he goes, ask this dog anything. He can answer any question. And the guy says, you know, what's your favorite part of the house? And the dog says, woof. And he goes, see, he said the roof. And he goes, who's the best baseball player? Woof. See, he said roof. You know, and then he go out and he gets, you see him thrown out. And he turns to the dog and he's like, what is your problem? And the dog goes, maybe I should have said DiMaggio. You know, the, and right, but I feel like what every question, the answer is roof. And that is, how fast are we growing? We're growing like 2%, 2.5%.
Two and a half,
and
right?
Some people are like, yes, we're going to take off. And the Fed is like, it's going to be great. And then others say, no, we're about to collapse. And it's always just the same woof. You know,
so is 2.5% just plodding? Is that where you are on,
yeah,
this?
Yeah, that's what I think. I think we're just going to kind of plod along. 2.5% is kind of the upper bound of what I think it's going to be. And so that's not great. It's not horrible. But I kind of think for 2016, most of the Democrats I talk to basically think the Republicans are crazy. They're going to nominate Donald Trump or somebody who's going to make it easy. And the economy is going to be booming. And so it's going to be great.
No, that's not gonna happen.
And I really don't think that. Yeah. I really don't think it is. I think it's going to be a lot tougher environment.
When you think of the systemic problems we have, this is a corollary to the
yes,
to the next one. Then, if you think GDP is the indicator, how important is are jobs and wages then? Right, because if you're discounting unemployment,
yeah.
But what we need for economic growth is people spending money out there. How are they going to do that without a 9-to-5 and a decent living wage?
Yes and no. I don't disagree that the weakest thing in the economy over the last 25 years is just basic, ordinary Americans' wages haven't been going up that, like they were,
right,
in the past. They're real wages. But I would just caution you, I think the reason the Fed has screwed this up so royally.
Stop right there. Have they?
Yeah, with their forecasts. That's what the Fed has screwed up royally with their forecasts, undeniably, for 8 straight years.
They've been saying,
oh my God, we're about to, right, take off starting next year.
Right.
And don't. Okay?
Right.
And
right,
so in 2009, right, they said it would be 10. We're finally going to take off.
Yeah.
10, 11,
yeah,
12, 13, 14. Because in the Fed's model, there's a lot of extremely capable economists within the Fed doing the forecast. But forecasting has been given up by academic. You go to academic economics department, nobody does forecasting because they say it's impossible.
What the hell do you guys do then?
we study the economy. What drives the economy.
Now that we know that.
Not
I feel much better now.
Not prediction. All right. All okay, right. So in the same way, if you went to the doctor and if you ask them, what day am I going to die? They're not going to have a great sense, but they're going to say, you shouldn't smoke, you should exercise, you know, be careful, take your medicine. They have in their machine a reversion to the mean. And it's fine. Right. There's a lot of investors who have the same thing, that they're waiting for stuff to get back to normal.
It eventually gets back to normal, right.
And getting back to normal, in their mind, is defined as what it was in 2006. In 2006,
that
wasn't normal. Right. And the reason
that was
I
totally
say that,
not rehearsed. That was totally not rehearsed. I have conversations all the time. It's not normal. Yeah.
But the premise of your question that what we need is for people to go back and spend, and until people start spending, we can't grow again. That's what's in the Fed's model. The Fed's model says, well, we know what happens when house prices go up, people start spending money. When gas prices go down, they're going to spend all of that money on stuff, and they're going to build houses. And so we're right around the corner from a takeoff. And I kind of don't think we actually are going to get people spending a ton. Okay. Uh-oh. The Fed.
God is angry.
The Fed.
Janet Yellen heard that.
I'm friends with Janet Yellen. You're doing a good job, Janet.
That's right. All right, wait.
So I think it's going to need to be more exports and more capital investment-led growth than it was in the 2000s. The 2000s were not sustainable. Consumers spending more than they were earning in income.
Yep.
House construction based on house price appreciation, something like 10 times greater than the historic average, neither of which is sustainable. So we're going to have to shift what the economy's doing, and that is my reasoning of why it hasn't been a faster comeback. It never was V-shaped because we couldn't go back to doing what we were doing before it began.
All right, we're going to geek out here for about 2 seconds. I want to follow up on exports and capital investment. So if we're going to lead, if exports are going to lead our growth, you need a weaker dollar.
Yes,
dollar's crazy strong.
It's killing us.
Exactly. Crazy strong.
Exactly. This is why when the Fed is like, oh, we think 2016's a year we're going to take off so we can start raising the rates. I go, no, wait a minute. You know, the dollar's already high. Now the U.S. interest rates are going to start rising while everybody else is going down. The dollar's going to go up even more.
All right. So that's a problem. Number two, capital investment. So you want companies to actually spend money.
Right.
Well, let me just stop right there. You want companies to spend money instead of returning to shareholders. And
not just buy other companies with it.
Right.
Yeah. And that's been slow.
All right. All right. Thus endeth the geeky thing. Sorry. You guys can follow up with questions if you like, which we'll do in like 25 minutes. I want to ask you about the thing that we're looking at Marketplace as we think about our election coverage, and that is this. The economic recovery has been going now for 75-something months, six-plus years, June 2009, right?
Yep.
Unemployment rate is 5.0%. The economy is growing, not as fast as you want, but it's growing. The headline numbers are if not really, really good, then certainly solid.
They look
normal. How come when I go out and talk to people, like I'm going to go down to Memphis tomorrow and do a bunch of interviews for our election coverage, they don't feel it out there? Their own economies feel lousy. What's the disconnect?
One, I don't think it's a disconnect. I think ordinary incomes of the median family haven't gone up in a long time. And economists argue about stuff, I mean, to really get in the weeds, is it about the price indices? Are we just not measuring? You know, now everybody has a phone. Mm-hmm. There's a famous book on economic growth that begins with King Leopold, whatever. He's the richest man in the world, and he's playing with his money, and he slams the chest that the gold pieces are in on his finger, and he gets an infection, just some basic infection, and he dies. Okay. And so it asks, what does it mean that the richest man in the world dies of a thing that the poorest person in the United States can just walk in a van for 50 cents, get an antibiotic. So is the poorest person today richer than the richest man in the world in 1400? Okay, now that's actually a question of price indices. So there is some dispute over the notion that middle class wages have been falling. And they say, no, we just haven't been measuring all the new stuff. But I think people know how much money they themselves have, and it hasn't gone up that much. People haven't gotten raises. There's been a lot of job insecurity. We had a horrible recession. All of those is part of it. And the second is, in politics, I can only think of two moments ever, or at least in our memories, where the political leaders were willing to get up and say, this is good and we did this. And those two moments are 1984, when the GDP growth rate is literally 6%, and the end of the 90s, when we have the stock market rising literally 25% a year for several years in a row, and we've added, you know, 20 million jobs. Both of those moments, totally off trend, not, you know, way three standard deviations above the mean. The fact that, so we were talking about it, a common friend of ours, Gene Sperling, was in the White House in 1996. And he says that in 1996, there was a big argument for the 96 election. Should we say the economy's better, or should we say we know the economy stinks, but it's not our fault, we inherited a problem? And they went back and forth, and they finally decided they would say, though we know there are some problems, we think the economy's getting better. 1996 was amazing. We're in the middle of an epic boom. The fact that they still were arguing in the White House about should we say the economy stinks, I think partly tells you politics has a very high bar before they're going to be willing to say anything positive.
So let me take you to politics for a minute. My boss, Deborah Clark, who's the executive producer of Marketplace, she's sitting right there.
She likes that you
say hi, Deborah.
Boss.
I know, she loves it.
Yeah, she's like, yes.
She loves that.
Do as I say. Yeah.
We had at your connecting us, we had breakfast this morning with David Axelrod, who is, as you guys know, the founder of this institute. And he had some very interesting things to say about politics and the economy and where we are today. I would be curious as to your take on, just because you spent 3 years in Washington, right? Your take on what is happening on the Republican side today with the economic populism, and also on the Democratic side with Bernie Sanders, and the state of the economy as we just described it, which is people aren't feeling it.
I mean, it seems like you don't have to be an Axelrod level of genius of insight into what people think to figure out those two are related. People aren't feeling it, and that leads them to other solutions, mm-hmm. or other, if they aren't solutions, claimed solutions. I think there is a guy who does research at Chicago Business School about financial crises. It's worth noting that every country that has basically ever had a financial crisis and had to bail out its financial system, the politics always become massively divisive and very populist, and essentially the fingers begin pointing over whose fault was this. Once they get past the, are we going to live?
Yeah.
Then everybody's like, whoo, okay, we live. Now, who did this? You did this. You did this. No, it wasn't our fault. It was the banks. No, it was the government. No, it was the Republicans. It was the Democrats. You know, so that is not unusual. What's happened in the United States, the like poisonous partisanship, is not unusual after financial crisis. And it's not unusual at this moment in a presidency. People forget, so the right before the midterm, the president came to town and he spoke about Northwestern. And I hadn't seen him for a while, and they called and they said, oh, he would really, you know, can you come up? He'd like to see you. And I came up. And so first I told him, I said, you know, the economy would probably be doing better if you weren't spending all your time with these Kellogg people. You know, and you came back down. He was in pretty good spirits, but everyone around him was like totally in the dumps. And they knew they were going to lose the midterm, and they're like just really sour. And I said, guys, they were envious. You seem so happy and rested and blah, blah, blah. And I said, look, guys, I said, I know what you feel like. It's the last 2 years, and there's gridlock, and you can't get anything done, and there's partisanship, and you can't get people to stay, and you can't attract talent. Everybody's trying to bail out, and they're like, you don't even know. It's worse than that. It's worse. And I said, think of it this way. The last 2 years under George W. Bush they were literally bookended by Hurricane Katrina and the worst financial crisis. So, you know, Bill Clinton's last 2 years, the man was impeached. Bush, the dad, voted out of office. Ronald Reagan, Iran-Contra. Jimmy Carter, hostage crisis, voted out of office. You got Watergate, Vietnam, assassination. Dwight Eisenhower had a heart attack and literally had to lay in his bed for 7 months of his last 2 years. I said, maybe it's going great. I mean, just brag about it. Look, here's what we did. We didn't do anything. I mean, you come to the tail end, I kind of think the main thing that's happening now is what always happens in year six, which is they're just trying to set up for 2017. Yeah. Because when stuff happens is once a new person comes in, you got a new mandate.
I want to ask you actually about the financial crisis because it, you know, Bear Stearns went under or was saved in March of 2008. Lehman Brothers was September. I mean, this is like ancient history practically.
Yeah.
And we're still in Columbus, Mississippi with a guy by the name of Jim Bob Harrison. He had the money quote of the day, right? So they've got like $6 billion of investment because they've organized in the past 10 years this economic development thing. They got Airbus to come in and make helicopters. And Jim Bob, we have this tape and it's great tape. And he said, you know, people thought we were walking around pregnant and barefoot with no teeth and burning crosses on the lawn, and now we're making things that fly, right? And honest to God, that's what happens. And so at the local level, you're seeing it. We were in Detroit, which is, as we all know, a really troubled city, and we went to Shinola, which is kind of an amazing sort of company and maker of watches and all that stuff. And they're doing it small and locally because, to get back to the really depressing point, they've given up on politics and the economic environment. You know, and that, I think, to get back to my own question earlier, that I think is the disconnect, right? I think the disconnect between the headline numbers now everybody's feeling is that people out there aren't paying, they read the news and they see the 5.0 unemployment and they go, okay, fine. And the disconnect is that they have to get up and go to work every single day and they just don't pay any attention to it, you know?
In a way, it's like politics has become the golf channel in that sense that if you love golf, you can watch golf 24 hours a day on that golf channel. And I understand there's going to be a second golf channel that's coming in to compete with them. So you won't even have to watch the ads. Right. You know, you could just switch back and forth. Right. But if you don't know how to golf, which I don't, I never see my life is purged of golf. I never see any golf. I don't have to watch golf. I can, you know, watch my own channel.
And
it seems like there's 5 million people watching the politics channel and everybody else is like, what?
That's exactly right. Yeah. Not even 5 million. You know, not even, and it's the Inside the Beltway channel, and then the New York Wall Street channel, and that's it.
I guess that's right. Okay, well, we wanted to save some time.
There we go.
And I'm an economist. You knew you were going to get some depressing. They thought a guy who knows about business and radio was going to be friendlier happier.
That's right.
But he delivered the same message I did. But worse, I was more optimistic than he was. You heard it.
Wow.
He was like, they've given up.
I'm an upbeat guy.
Okay, so we've got roving microphones, I think.
We do.
And I'll just give you one warning. There's a little theater in the old executive office building, the White House Theater. And when they crank up the lights, if you're sitting on the stage, you can't really see. So I would always say, we have people with a microphone, so we can't see you, but we can hear you. So if you have the microphone, just assume you have the floor. And it was early, it was 2009, and they had this conference about small business and why isn't small business coming back faster? And there's always one guy, the guy in the front row stands up with the first question, raises his hand, he stands up, they hand him the microphone, but it turns out there were two microphones. So that guy goes to say something, and somebody else over the speaker starts making the most offensive pronouncement. He's like, what this problem in this country is, women took all men's jobs and the following groups are lazy and something, and everybody's like, ugh. And they look, and everybody assumes it's this guy in the front. And he's just like, what? And he throws it down and he yells like, he's like, it's not me. You know? So okay, but here, everyone can see you, so just be mindful, you know, when you ask a question of that fact.
But okay, there are two microphones, I'll tell you that. Yeah. All right, ready to go.
Here we got one right in the front. Oh, all right.
Hi, in the state of Illinois, it's worse than watching golf. It's like watching grass grow. So, Kai, you're welcome to Illinois. We've been 5 months without a state budget.
I thought you were going to say like some mixed martial arts.
I don't do sports. So when we think about the impact of no budget in the state of Illinois and how it's really hitting the most vulnerable and removing safety nets, how do we think about, you know, how is growth even possible for bringing people out of the bottom, and then how it's impacting sort of very middle class and working middle class people with very basic needs like childcare subsidies?
Thoughts? I mean, partly this goes to the same thing that we're both talking about here, which is how important is the government to growth? And in the short run, we could go 6 months. I have no doubt we could go for a year or a year and a half or something without a budget. And certain groups are going to be hurt. A lot of people, you're going to talk to them, but they're going to say, well, I didn't even know the government was shut down. I don't know who the governor is. I don't know. I've given up on politics. I'm not interested. And my own view on that is there's a big clash of worldviews of where does growth come from. And partly it's kind of fallen out in a partisan way, partly not. One worldview says it is from the absence of government that growth comes from. And if you believe in that, it says get the taxes as low as possible, get the regulations as low as possible, and the economy will grow. And the other side says that it's the quality of your people and their talent and investments in some public infrastructure and backbone that you got to lay the groundwork for growth. And I'm more in the latter camp. My question to the people who say it's all about low taxes is, why are places like Silicon Valley in California, which has always been a high tax, high regulation state? And the answer is obvious. It's because that's where the talented people are. And it's not, there's an island called Vanuatu. It's a nation. And as I understand it, the island of Vanuatu has no taxes of any kind on anything. And there are some audiences who, when I finish, they're like, where is this island of Vanuatu? You know, but why isn't Silicon Valley in Vanuatu, where there are no taxes? And the answer is because there are no Stanford graduates there. There's no coders. You got it. And it costs money to get your people up to that kind of level. I'm nervous over the long run that even if we can go 6 months or a year or whatever and we can make it work, that fundamentally, if we're shooting ourselves in the foot, I'm nervous for what does that mean for the future of Illinois compared to other states. But yeah, I don't really have an answer of how you fix the standoff, because you know it's almost like it's a battle of identity, not just interests. And identity is a lot harder to figure out than interests. Yeah.
No, I would just, to get back to the beginning of what Austan was saying, right? There are some groups that are going to be hurt because, just for example, childcare services won't be available, and single moms or single dads won't be able to drop their kid off and get to the job, so they're going to have to stay home and they're going to lose those jobs. And that's where you see the damage happening, right? At those lower levels among the most vulnerable populations, which are, as we all know, the most invisible populations, right? And that's where the real damage is done. And that's sort of the long-term stressor point, I think, as you start thinking about how this plays out over time, whether it's 6 months or a year. That's all I got.
I like how you used the phrase
stressor point
in a sentence. That was that was impressive. Okay, but
If you've got a microphone, you have the floor.
Yeah.
There you go.
Simpson Bowles, was it a good idea? Why didn't it happen? And are the sequester cuts moving us in that direction?
That's a great question. So Bowles Simpson was the deficit reduction commission set up by the president. Erskine Bowles and Alan Simpson, former senator from Wyoming, made some very stringent recommendations on deficit reduction that were not adopted by your former boss. Discuss.
First, it was Simpson Bowles. It wasn't Bowles Simpson.
Oh.
Because Simpson himself said, if it was Bowles Simpson, then everybody would abbreviate it the BS committee, and so he didn't want that. So they called it Simpson Bowles. It essentially took what I thought was a very mature attitude toward deficit. It said, let's not get in a pie of sky is falling scare tech. Let's add up. If you wanted to stabilize the debt to GDP ratio of the United States and started shrinking, how much deficit reduction would you need to do over 10 years? And they got a target amount. And then they said, okay, let's not punt it off today. Let's come up with an actual plan to do it. And they did it the Washington way. There was a couple of trillion of tax increase. So a couple of, we get some on cutting discretionary spending. We get some from cutting entitlements. And we'll add the whole thing together. Now, there's a bogusness in Washington. There's at least one bogusness in Washington budget accounting, which is they don't do anything in net present value. They add it up over 10 years. So 1 trillion of the 4 trillion was saved interest payments, okay, which in my world is not a thing, but they counted part of their deficit reduction would come from saved interest payments. The Simpson-Bowles Commission itself was not able to vote to support its own plan.
Right.
Because it was made up of Republicans and Democrats, and the Republicans in the House said, we won't tolerate any tax increases. So it was just a personal recommendation of Simpson and of Bowles. It was the chairman's recommendation. The reason why at the moment it came out, Obama did not feel that he could just say, I want to do Simpson-Bowles, is in it, he had made a promise not to raise anyone's taxes less than $250,000.
Right.
And one of the first things in Simpson-Bowles was raise taxes on a lot of people, including less than $250,000. And the president, I think, was, I love as the professor to be able to say somebody's being politically naive, but I do think they were being, Simpson and Bowles were being a little politically naive to think that the president would just get up and say, I embrace cutting Social Security, raising taxes on the middle class as a rational and mature starting point, let's have a negotiation. He thought, quite correctly, that if he did that, the first thing they would do is say, we told you he's a liar, and he's a liar, now he's proposed to do it. Though he did say at that time, if you want to have the negotiation over the grand bargain, I will have it with you. But we all will have to give up, so we will have to have high-income tax cuts plus the cuts you want to get. If you want to have that, let's have it. And my feeling, we could go back in the history, was the original Ryan budget, instead of saying Simpson-Bowles was essentially $2 trillion of cuts, $1 trillion of revenue. The president wanted $2 trillion of cuts, I mean, $2 trillion of tax increases and $2 trillion for $2 trillion of cuts. And the first Ryan budget was negative $1 trillion tax cuts and pay for it with that much more government spending cuts. So it was just kind of, they weren't going anywhere. And I'll just give you one money quote, and we'll go to the next one. I asked the pollster, they came back later, and they said, ask the pollster, why don't they do Simpson-Bowles? So I asked the president's pollster, Joel Benenson, what do people think about Simpson-Bowles as a plan? And he said, your people all want to know about Simpson-Bowles. And I said, yes. They asked me that. He said, my people in the focus groups think that's a stomach condition.
Wow.
He was like, nobody's talking about Simpson-Bowles. It's not on anyone. They don't even know anything about it or what it is. And that was kind of the golf channel. It's back to the golf channel.
Yeah. Who's got the mic? Let's work them down front here, shall we? There we go.
I have a question. In a zero interest rate environment, how do you expect corporate leadership to choose investment in capital spending and research, which would improve productivity, over buying stock back and asset appreciation? How do you expect corporate leadership to make that choice in a zero interest rate environment?
I actually expect corporations to understand social responsibility and what that means and the role of the corporation in modern society. I don't know what you think.
Okay. I would say, to be more theoretical about it, the 0% interest environment ought to, in our normal economic world, ought to encourage capital investment like never before. What matters in the formula, an economist got a formula for everything, but the formula says that cost of capital should matter, which is the interest rate plus the depreciation rate times the tax treatment. The tax treatment has basically never been more favorable for investment. The interest rate is zero. If there ever was a moment when you should be saying it's worth making costs today that will pay off in the future, it's at the moment when we have zero interest rate, and yet
so,
they are.
So why aren't they doing that? Why aren't they doing that?
I think it's because they're still lurking down in the reptilian brain of our business leaders, this experience of the financial crisis in which their friends who did not have liquid assets died. And so they're like, I'm never going to put myself in that position again. I'm going to be King Leopold, and I'm going to have some boxes of money right here at my firm, and I'm going to sit on this money because if it really hits the fan again, the bank pulled my lines of credit, and I couldn't get any money, and I know guys that went under. And so there's like a buffer stock of savings that corporations never had before that now they sit on cash. If you look at the cash, and it's not just in the U.S., so that's what makes me think it's not from U.S. policy that they're not investing. This is in all the advanced countries of the world, you see the same thing. Super low interest rates, they're sitting on money, they're profitable, and yet they're not investing. And so I think it's that. Now, you seem skeptical.
Well, I think you're letting them off the hook a little bit, right? Because it's been that way for a long, long time. When tax environments have been favorable and interest rates have been relatively low, companies have you know, sat on their money, and they are quite often loath to make those capital investments because it's spending money without the, you know, necessarily the promise of return.
That may be true. I think that's a better way of saying what I'm saying. I don't think they think stuff's going that great, and their view is we built a bunch of overcapacity, so why would we go build new factories? You know, a bit like the juniorized version of what's happened in China.
Yep.
Okay, China used to be an export-based model, and they aren't really an export-based model anymore. They're investment-led model because the government tells them, we got problems, build more factories. There was a Simpsons. If you ever watch the Simpsons, Maggie's the baby, and they put Maggie in this daycare, and they throw all the babies in this big pit of plastic balls. And it turns out, from the baby's perspective, it's a nightmare. They hate them all. They're this. And they struggle, and they finally climb to the top. And you see Maggie waving to the person, you know, sucking on the pacifier. And the assistant says, the children seem agitated. And there he goes, add more balls. You know, dump all the balls. That's China. That's China with this. Yeah. They're just like, things are slowing. There are problems. Yeah. Build more factories. You know, they build them, but... Boy, when you do that, when left to the private sector, if you got overcapacity, I think that's mostly why they're.
Yeah, that's why they're. We've got the mic. Here we go.
Thank you for the opportunity. So I understand and agree with the point that maybe not many people are paying close attention to national politics, but I don't think that automatically makes national politics irrelevant. Likewise, not many people, I think, are paying attention to Wall Street, but all of a sudden it goes crazy and drag everybody down, even though, including those people, having zero interest in it. So I guess my question is, even though we accept that maybe national politics wouldn't do any favor to the economy, would it be possible that it would pose serious threat or risk to the economy in the next couple of years? Thank you.
Oh, so can Congress and the government hurt the economy? I don't know. Let me ask you, and then I'll weigh in, because I went first last time.
Okay. I think that's an insightful question. Yep. Thank you for asking it that way. I don't disagree with you that they could. It's a bit of a joke, but it's not really a joke to say, if I told you that they weren't going to do a single thing for 2 years until the next president was elected, truly, that's the best case scenario that could happen. That's probably what will happen, but with a 5% chance that like something really awful happens. They default on the U.S. debt for no reason, or there's some huge tax increase, or some massive government shutdown or something like that. That said, 90% of what happens in the economy has nothing to do with Washington. So mostly I don't think if you ask what are the true black swans that would freak everyone out, I think they're to be found China or Europe. It's not really the US, not really Washington. Stuff could be very frustrating. Consumer confidence, for whatever reason, does respond quite negatively to government shutdowns. And yeah, I don't know if it's the, like, we don't like to see our parents fighting or what is the thing, but the only thing bigger than 9/11, bigger than anything except Lehman in 2008, the fall of Lehman and the financial crisis, that first threatened government shutdown in 2011 cut consumer confidence more than anything except Lehman. It was the biggest drop ever, and the second biggest drop after Lehman was over the government shutdown this last time. So I think they could do that, but I still think that's kind